the lecture about diagnosis and management of ectopic pregnancy, green top guideline. Introduction and background epidemiology. Ectopic pregnancy is any pregnancy implanted outside of the endometrial cavity. In the UK, the incidence is approximately 11 per 1,000 pregnancies. About 11 ectopic pregnancies diagnosed each year. The incidence of ectopic pregnancy in women attending early pregnancy unit is 2 to 3%. Unfortunately, women still die from ectopic pregnancy, with 6 maternal deaths reported between 2006 and 2008. However, the case fertility rate has decreased over recent years, suggesting that early diagnosis and treatment may have made an impact. Risk factor for ectopic pregnancy include tubal damage following surgery or infection, smoking, in vitro fertilization. The majority of women with ectopic pregnancy have no identifiable risk factor. How to diagnose of ectopic pregnancy? How is the tubal pregnancy diagnosis? What are the ultrasound criteria? Transvaginal ultrasound is the diagnostic tool of choice for tubal ectopic pregnancy. Tubal ectopic pregnancy should be positively identified if possible by visualizing adnexial mass that moves separate to the ovary. The majority of tubal ectopic pregnancy should be visualized on transvaginal ultrasound. Transvaginal ultrasound has reported sensitivities of 87.19% and specificities of 94 to 99.9% for the diagnosis of ectopic pregnancy. The majority of ectopic pregnancy will be visualized on the initial ultrasound examination. The remainder will initially be classified as pregnancy of unknown location. Laparoscopy is no longer the gold standard for diagnosis because false negative laparoscopy, 3 to 4.5%, have been reported when the procedure is performed too early in the development of ongoing ectopic pregnancy. An inhomogeneous or non-cystic adnexial mass is the most common finding, is around 50 to 60% of cases. Empty extrauterine gestational sac will be present in around 20 to 40% of cases, while extrauterine gestational sac containing yolk sac and or embryonic pole that may not have cardiac activity will be present in around 15 to 20% of cases. There is no specific endometrial appearance or sickness to support a diagnosis of tubal ectopic pregnancy. In up to 20% of cases, a collection of fluid may be seen within the uterine cavity, classically referred to as pseudo sac. The key is to distinguish this from early intrauterine gestational sac by the intradecidual and double decidual sign can be used to diagnose early intrauterine pregnancy. The intradecidual sign is described as the fluid collection with echogenic rim located with immaculately signate decidua on one side of the uterine cavity. The double decidual sign is described as intrauterine fluid collection surrounded by two concentric echogenic rim. In practice, it can be very difficult to distinguish pseudosac with is just a collection of fluid in the endometrial cavity from early intrauterine sac. The presence of pseudosac alone cannot be used to diagnose ectopic pregnancy, and in fact, small echogenic cyst structure is more likely to be early sac rather than a pseudosac, has 0.02% probability of ectopic pregnancy, while the probability of 19.98% for intrauterine pregnancy. Free fluid is often seen on the ultrasound but is not diagnostic of ectopic pregnancy because a small amount of echogenic fluids in the pouch of the glass may be found in both intrauterine and ectopic pregnancy. Echogenic fluid has been reported in 28 to 56% of ectopic pregnancies. That may signify tubal rupture, but most commonly is due to blood leaking from the fimbriel end of the fallopian tube. What biochemical investigation should be carried out? A serum progesterone level is not useful in predicting ectopic pregnancy. A serum beta human chorionic gonadotropin level is useful for planning the management of ultrasound visualized ectopic pregnancy. Meta-analysis has confirmed that the single beta CG level cannot be used in isolation to predict ectopic pregnancy. There is a common misconception that a single low serum PCG level, example less than 1000 international values, means that the ectopic pregnancy is unlikely. This is a false assumption, and in modern practice, many ectopic pregnancies have PCG well below this level. The initial serum PCG level is the key prognostic indicator for the success of conservative management, expectant and medical in case of ultrasound visualized tubal ectopic pregnancy. How is a cervical pregnancy diagnosed? What are the ultrasound criteria? The following ultrasound criteria may be used. First of all, empty uterine cavity. Second, a parallel shaped cervix. Third, a gestational sac present below the level of internal cervical os. The absence of the sliding sign. And finally, blood flow around the gestational sac using color Doppler. The sliding sign enables cervical ectopic pregnancy to be distinguished from miscarriages that are within the cervical canal. When pressure is applied to the cervix using the probe in a miscarriage, the gestational sac is sliding against the endocervical canal, but it does not implicate cervical pregnancy. What biochemical investigation should be carried out? A single serum PCG should be carried out at diagnosis. A single serum PCG carried out at the time of ultrasound diagnosis is useful in deciding management option. A serum PCG level greater than 10,000 is associated with a decreased chance of successful methotrexate treatment. How is a caesarean scar pregnancy diagnosed? What are the ultrasound criteria? Clinicians should be aware that the ultrasound is the primary diagnostic modality using a transvaginal approach supplemented by transabdominal imaging if required. Defined criteria for diagnosis caesarean scar pregnancy on transvaginal scan has been described. MRI can be used as a second line investigation if the diagnosis is equivocal and there is local expertise in the MRI diagnosis of caesarean scar pregnancy. Caesarean scar pregnancy is defined as implantation into the mitral defect occurring at the site of the previous uterine incision. The prevalence of caesarean scar pregnancy estimated to be approximately 1 in 2,000 pregnancies. The diagnostic criteria described for diagnosis caesarean scar implantation or the transvaginal ultrasound include empty uterine cavity, gestational sac or solid mass or trophoblast located anteriorly at the level of the internal os embedded at the site of the previous lower uterine segment caesarean section scar. Thin or absent layer of myometrium between the gestational sac and the bladder. Evidence of prominent trophoblastic or placental circulation on Doppler examination. Empty endocervical canal. 13% of reported cases of caesarean scar pregnancy were misdiagnosed as intrauterine or cervical pregnancy at presentation. The MRI features of caesarean scar pregnancy are essentially the same as those described on ultrasound, but the ultrasound is more readily available and cheaper. What biochemical investigation should be carried out? No biochemical investigation are needed routinely. A serum-based CG level may be useful as a baseline prior to monitoring if conservative management is implemented, but it does not have a role in the diagnosis of caesarean scar pregnancy. How is the interstitial pregnancy diagnosis? What are the ultrasound criteria? Ultrasound criteria have been described for the diagnosis of interstitial pregnancy. This include empty uterine cavity, product of conception gestational sac located laterally in the interstitial and intramural part of the tube and surrounded by less than 5 mm of myometrium in all imaging plans. The interstitial line sign, which is a thin echogenic line extended from the central uterine cavity echo to the periphery of the interstitial sac. The interstitial line sign have been shown to have a sensitivity of 80% and a specificity of 98% for the diagnosis of interstitial ectopic pregnancy. Sonographic finding in two dimension can be further confirmed using three-dimensional ultrasound where available to avoid misdiagnosis with the early intrauterine or angular implantation in the lateral angles of the uterine cavity pregnant. Supplementation with MRI can also be helpful in the diagnosis of interstitial pregnancy. Interstitial pregnancy occurs when the ectopic pregnancy implant in the interstitial part of the fallopian tubes. The report of evidence varies between 1% and 6.3% of ectopic pregnancy. The interstitial part of the fallopian tube is about 1 to 2 cm in length and transfers the muscular myometrium of the uterine wall opening via tubal ostium into the uterine cavity. What biochemical investigation should be carried out? A single serum based CG should be carried out at diagnosis to help with management. In some cases, repeat serum based CG in 48 hours may be useful in deciding further management. At presentation based on clinical symptom and ultrasound scan, if there is suspicion of interstitial pregnancy, a single serum based CG should be carried out. This does not contribute to the diagnosis, but can be useful in deciding management option such as surgical, medical, or expectant treatment. The overall decision regarding management option depend on clinical presentation, the size of the interstitial pregnancy, presence of fetal cardiac activity, and finally the serum BCG level. How is a cornual pregnancy diagnosed? What are the ultrasound criteria? The following ultrasound can be criteria described in the literature can be used for the diagnosis of cornual pregnancy. Visualization of a single interstitial portion of the fallopian tube in the main uterine body. Gestational sac or product of the conception seen mobile and separate from the uterus and completely surrounded by myometrium. A vascular pedicle adjoining the gestational sac to the unicornate uterus. What biochemical investigation should be carried out? A single serum based CG should be carried out at the diagnosis to help with management. In some cases, a repeat serum based CG in 48 hours may be useful in deciding further management. Based on clinical symptom and ultrasound scan, if there is any suspicion of cornual pregnancy, single serum based CG is useful for planning management. The overall decision regarding management options, surgical, medical, or expectant management depend on the clinical presentation, the size of cornual pregnancy, and the serum BCG limit. How is ovarian pregnancy diagnosed? What are the ultrasound criteria? There are no specific agreed criteria for the ultrasound diagnosis of ovarian ectopic pregnancy. Findings suggesting of ovarian ectopic pregnancy on transvaginal ultrasound is the empty uterus are a wide echogenic range with internal echogenic area on the ovary. A yolk sac or embryo is seen less commonly. It is not possible to separate the cystic lip structure or gestational sac from the ovary on genital palpation. Negative sliding organ sign. The corpus luteum should be identified separate from the suspected ovarian pregnancy. Color Doppler may aid detection of fetal heart pulsations in the ovary. A complex echogenic adnexial mass with free fluid in the pouch of Douglas can represent a ruptured ovarian ectopic pregnancy. It is difficult to distinguish ovarian ectopic pregnancy from the corpus luteal cyst. Tubal ectopic pregnancy stuck to the ovary, a second corpus luteum ovarian germ cell tumor, and the other ovarian pathology. Diagnosis is usually confirmed surgically and histologically. What biochemical investigation should be carried out? A single serum BCG should be carried out at diagnosis to help with management. In some cases, a repeat serum BCG in 48 hours may be useful in deciding further management. Ovarian ectopic pregnancy can be difficult to diagnose with centrally preoperatively, so the diagnosis should be considered whenever ultrasound finds a suspicion. After surgical treatment, the histopathology result will confirm the diagnosis of ovarian ectopic pregnancy. How is abdominal pregnancy diagnosed? What are the ultrasound criteria? Divine ultrasound criteria can be used to diagnose abdominal pregnancy. MRI can be useful diagnostic adjunct and advanced abdominal pregnancy and can help to plan the surgical approach. The following ultrasound criteria have been suggested as being diagnostic of earlier abdominal pregnancy: absence of intrauterine gestational sac, absence of both an evident dilated tube and the complex adnexial mass, a gestational cavity surrounded by loops of bowel and separated from them by peritoneum, and a wide motility similar to fluctuation of the sacs, particularly evident with the pressure of the transvaginal probe toward the posterior cul-de-sac. What biochemical investigation should be carried out? A higher index of suspicion is based on the elevated serum BCG level in combination with ultrasound finding. An early abdominal pregnancy is usually diagnosed at laparoscopy during investigation for persistently elevated serum BCG level. How is this heterotopic pregnancy diagnosed? What are the ultrasound criteria? A heterotopic pregnancy is diagnosed when the ultrasound finding demonstrate intrauterine pregnancy and coexisting ectopic pregnancy. Heterotopic pregnancy should be considered in A. All women presenting after assisted reproductive technology. B. Women with intrauterine pregnancy complaining of persistent pelvic pain. C. Those women with persistently raised BCG level following miscarriage or termination of pregnancy. What biochemical investigation should be carried out? A serum BCG level is of limited value in diagnosis of heterotopic pregnancy. Management option. What are the surgical and pharmacological or conservative treatment options for tubal pregnancy? A laparoscopic surgical approach is preferable to the open approach. In the presence of a healthy contralateral tube, salvingectomy should be performed in preference to the salvingectomy. In women with a history of fertility reducing factor, previous ectopic pregnancy, contralateral tubal damage, previous abdominal surgery, previous pelvic inflammatory disease, salvingectomy should be considered. If a salvingectomy is performed, women should be informed about the risk of persistent trophoblast with the need for serum BCG level follow-up. They should also be counseled that there is a small risk that there may be need further treatment in form of systemic methotrexate or salvingectomy. Systemic methotrexate may be offered to suitable women with a tubal ectopic pregnancy. It should never be given as the first visit unless the diagnosis of ectopic pregnancy is absolutely clear and viable intrauterine pregnancy has been excluded. Expectant management is the option for clinically stable women with ultrasound diagnosis of ectopic pregnancy and decreasing BCG level initially less than 1,500 international units. Surgical management. The majority of tubal ectopic pregnancies are managed surgically. Laparoscopy is preferable to laparotomy due to its many advantages, such as short operation times, less intraoperative blood loss, shorter hospital stay, lower cost, lower analgesic requirement, and less adhesion formation. Evidence suggests that there is no difference in terms of health benefit between the laparoscopy and laparotomy, including the key outcome of subsequent successful pregnancy. A randomized control trial on the woman with laparoscopy confirmed tubal ectopic pregnancy and healthy contralateral tubes has found that the cumulative ongoing pregnancy rate was 60.7% after salvingectomy and 56.2% after salpingectomy. Persistent trophoblasts occurred more frequently in salpingectomy groups, 7%, versus less than 1%. Repeat ectopic pregnancies occur in 8% in salpingectomy groups and 5% in salpingectomy groups. It was concluded that in women with tubal ectopic pregnancy and a healthy contralateral tube, salpingectomy does not significantly improve fertility prospect compared with the salpingectomy. A higher rate of subsequent intrauterine pregnancies have been found if salpingectomy is performed rather than salpingectomy in women with a history of fertility reducing factor, previous ectopic pregnancy, contralateral tube, previous abdominal surgery, and previous PID. One study found a subsequent intrauterine pregnancy rate of 75% with salpingectomy and 40% with salpingectomy in such women. However, subsequent intrauterine pregnancy rate were greater than 90% in both groups. NICE recommend that women undergoing salpingectomy have a serum BCG level taken 7 days after surgery and then weekly until a negative result is obtained. Studies report persistent trophoblast rate of 3.9 to 11% after salpingectomy. Factors that have been suggested increasing the risk of developing persistent trophoblast include higher preoperative serum BCG level, a rapid preoperative rise in the serum BCG, a larger tubal mass. Pharmacological management. Methotrexate at the dose of 50 mg has been shown widely used as a single dose instead of repeated surgical procedure. The use of prophylactic methotrexate at the time of laparoscopic salpingectomy has been reported and in one randomized trial when compared to simple salpingectomy alone. There was a significant reduction in the rate of persistent trophoblast. Randomized control trial comparing methotrexate with laparoscopic surgery have shown methotrexate to be equally successful to surgery in certain cases of tubal ectopic pregnancy. While it can be given a multiple dose regimen, methotrexate is most commonly given a single intramuscular dose of 50 milligram. Serum BCG level are measured on day 4 and 7 post methotrexate. If the BCG level decreases by more than 15% between day 4 and day 7, BCG level are then measured weekly until less than 15 international units. If the level does not decrease by 15%, a repeat transvaginal ultrasound should be considered to exclude ectopic fetal cardiac activity and the presence of significant hemoperitoneum. Consideration may be then given to administration of a second dose of methotrexate. Overall, success rate of the single dose of methotrexate for tubal ectopic pregnancy range from 65 to 95% within 3 to 27% of women requiring a second dose. Success rate vary considerably due to different inclusion criteria. The largest single study to date have been on 559 cases of ectopic pregnancy, where the success rate of methotrexate was found to be 90.7%. There are number of predictors of success. First of all, initial serum BCG level, success rate are higher with lower BCG level. Success rate of 81 to 98% have been reported if the serum BCG level are less than 1,000 international unit, compared with the only 38% if the BCG level greater than 5,000 international. Second, ultrasound appears appearance of ectopic pregnancy, the presence of yolk sac, fetal pool, and or fetal cardiac activity are significant predictor of failure. Success rate are higher with when no gestational sac is visualized. Third, preterm change in the serum BCG level, the smaller the increase in BCG level prior to administration of methotrexate, the higher the chance of successful medical management. A BCG increase of up to 11 to 20% over 48 hours prior to the administration of methotrexate have been associated with higher rate of success. Finally, decrease in BCG level from day 1 to day 4 after methotrexate, success rate of 80 to 100% have been reported if the serum BCG level decreased from day 1 to day 4 post administration of methotrexate compared with the only 48 to 62% if the serum BCG level increases. During treatment with methotrexate, women should be advised to avoid alcohol and folate-containing vitamin. The adverse effect including pulmonary suppression, pulmonary fibrosis, non-specific pneumonitis, liver cirrhosis, renal failure, and gastric ulceration. The most common adverse effect is excessive flatulence and bloating due to intestinal gas formation, transient mild elevation in liver enzyme and stomatitis. The contraindication to methotrexate: hemodynamically instability, the presence of intrauterine pregnancy, breastfeeding, if unable to comply with follow-up, non-sensitivity to methotrexate, chronic liver disease, pre-existing blood dyscrasia, active pulmonary disease, immunodeficiency, and peptic ulcer disease. A good candidate for methotrexate have the following characteristics: hemodynamically stable, low serum BCG, ideally less than 1,500 international, but can be up to 5,000 international. No fetal cardiac activity seen on ultrasound scan. Little is that there is no intrauterine pregnancy, willingness to attend for follow-up, no non-sensitivity to methotrexate. Single dose protocol for intramuscular methotrexate: day 1, serum BCG, urinary creatinine, liver function test, full blood count, blood group, and day 4 serum BCG, and day 7 serum BCG. If BCG decrease less than 15% day 4, day 7, for repeated transvaginal ultrasound and methotrexate 50 mg. Per meter square, if still fulfill criteria for medical management. If BCG decrease greater than 15 day 4, day 7 for repeat, PHCG weekly until level less than 15. NICE recommended that the methotrexate should be the first line management for women who are able to return for follow-up and who have no significant pain, and ruptured ectopic pregnancy with mass smaller greater than 35 millimeters with no visible heartbeat. A serum BCG between 1,500 and 5,000 international. No intrauterine pregnancy. In the event of serum BCG dropping, then expectant management may be appropriate. Should the serum BCG be rising at the rate that may be consistent with available intrauterine pregnancy, then a repeat scan to check the diagnosis before administering methotrexate is advisable. There are many well-documented cases of women with intrauterine pregnancy treated for suspected ectopic pregnancy with methotrexate. Methotrexate should therefore never be given at the first visit unless the diagnosis of ectopic pregnancy is absolutely clear and available intrauterine pregnancy has been excluded. Expectant management is a reasonable option for appropriately selected and counseled women. Must be willing and able to attend for follow-up, have minimal pain, have low or declining serum BCG level. Reported success rate range from 57 to 100% and are very dependent on case selection. Success rate are inversely proportional to the serum BCG level, with the lower success rate associated with the higher initial serum BCG level. A decreasing serum BCG level is also a good predictor of success. Cervical pregnancy. What are the cervical? What are the surgical and pharmacological or conservative treatment option for ectopic, for cervical ectopic pregnancy? Medical management with methotrexate can be considered for cervical pregnancy. Surgical method of management are associated with a higher failure rate and should be reserved for those women suffering life-threatening bleeding. Early and accurate diagnosis is a key factor in the conservative management of cervical pregnancy. Gestational sac less than 12 weeks, absence of the fetal cardiac activity and lower serum BCG level are associated with more successfully conservative management. A variety of methods have been described: dilatation and curettage, systemic methotrexate, local injection with potassium chloride or methotrexate. A retrospective review of 62 cases of cervical ectopic pregnancy estimated that the efficacy of the systemic methotrexate administration in the treatment of cervical ectopic pregnancy to be approximately 91%. There was, however, no standard protocol for of methotrexate used, and success cases require surgical debulking or local injection of methotrexate in addition to systemic therapy. In addition, combination therapies, intrauterine and neonatal injection seem to increase the chance of successful treating in the retrospective study. A number of objective methods to control hemorrhage in the treatment of cervical ectopic pregnancy have been described. This includes uterine artery ligation and uterine artery embolization. Case series reported success with this method in combination with intracervical or systemic methotrexate, but the number of cases reported are small and associated with complications, including infection, uterine infarction, sciatic nerve injury, and necrosis of the bladder or rectum. More recently, small cases, series of 5 women with cervical ectopic pregnancy treated with hysteroscopic resection and uterine artery embolization has been described. Caesarean scar pregnancy. What are the surgical, pharmacological, or conservative treatment? Women diagnosed with caesarean section scar, the pregnancy should be counseled about such pregnancy associated with severe maternal morbidity and mortality. Medical and surgical intervention with or without additional hemostatic measurement should be considered in women with first trimester caesarean scar pregnancy. To date, there are 35 cases of ongoing caesarean section scar pregnancy that were diagnosed in the first trimester, where the woman chose to continue with the pregnancy. There have also been numerous small cases series and case report 42 of intra-abdominal rupture and severe vaginal hemorrhage as the point of diagnosis or following intervention. Primary medical treatment consists of using methotrexate, which may be administered by local injection into the gestational sac under ultrasound guidance or systemically by intramuscular injection. Local injection seem to be a more effective means of terminating the pregnancy. The disadvantage of using medical treatment is that the trophoblast remain in situ. There is a risk of hemorrhage and as is retained of in very vascular placental tissues degenerate. So many authors have advocated using suction evacuation in addition to methotrexate to hasten resolution and reduce the risk of unpredictable hemorrhage in the follow-up period. Surgical treatment consists of either evacuation of the pregnancy using suction of hysteroscopic resection or excision of the pregnancy as open laparoscopic or transvaginal procedure. Expectant management may be suitable for women with a small non-viable scar pregnancy and may be considered if the pregnancy is partially implanted into the scar and grow into the uterine cavity, provided that the woman is counseled regarding the society's potential risk, hemorrhage and morbid uterine placentation and the declined treatment of the pregnancy. The management of ongoing second trimester scar pregnancy is challenging with the high risk of maternal morbidity and hysterectomy, whichever approach is taken. Interstitial pregnancy. What are the surgical and pharmacological or conservative treatment options for interstitial pregnancy? Non-surgical management is acceptable option for stable interstitial pregnancy. Expectant management is only suitable for women with low or significantly falling BCG level in whom the addition of methotrexate may not improve the outcome. A pharmacological approach using methotrexate has been shown to effective, although there is sufficient evidence to recommend local or systemic approach. Surgical management by laparoscopic corneal resection or salpingotomy is effective option. Alternative surgical technique could include hysteroscopic resection under laparoscopic or ultrasound guidance. There is insufficient evidence on safety and complication in future pregnancy to recommend other non-surgical methods. The likely success of conservative management is determined by the initial level of serum BCG. The option for conservative management include expectant management or pharmacological approach using local or systemic methotrexate. Other reported surgical technique includes selective uterine artery embolization in conjunction with the methotrexate to reduce hemorrhage. The disadvantage with this technique are uncertainly about the safety and complication in future pregnancy. Cornual pregnancy. What are the surgical and pharmacological or conservative treatment option for cornual pregnancy? Should be managed by excision of the rudimentary horn via laparoscopy or laparotomy. Conservative laparoscopic and open surgery methods of management have all been described. There are several reported cases of methotrexate and potassium chloride injection prior to later laparoscopic rudimentary horn excision. However, to avoid recurrence, excision of the rudimentary horn seems to be the best approach. The laparoscopic technique is safe, but attention needs to be paid to the possibility of the urinary tract abnormalities which can be associated with the unicornate uterus. The techniques involve excision of the fibrous band that attaches the rudimentary horn to the unicornate uterus with removal of the rudimentary horn through the secondary port. Ovarian pregnancy. What are the surgical and pharmacological or conservative treatment? Definite surgical treatment is preferred if laparoscopy is required to make the diagnosis of ovarian ectopic pregnancy. Systemic methotrexate can be used to treat ovarian ectopic pregnancy when the risk of surgery is higher or postoperatively is the presence of persistent residual trophoblastic or persistently raised BCG level. Minimal access surgery is now the treatment of choice for ovarian ectopic pregnancy. Removal of the gestational product by incisions or with resection in the presence of large ectopic mass is preferred. Enucleating the product of conception bluntly from the ovary means damage to the surrounding ovarian tissues. Hemostasis can be achieved by electrocautery or suturing. Ovarectomy is occasionally required when there is coexisting as the vitre is the laterals, ipsilateral ovarian pathology or excessive bleeding. Abdominal pregnancy. What are the surgical, pharmacological or conservative treatment? Laparoscopy removal is option for treatment of early abdominal pregnancy. Possible alternative treatment method would be systemic methotrexate with ultrasound guided fetuside. Advanced abdominal pregnancy should be managed by laparotomy. Laparoscopic treatment is safe and effective option for the management of abdominal pregnancy when the diagnosis is made early and the site of implantation does not involve a vascular area. Laparoscopic management has been associated with reduced operative time, blood loss, and length of the hospital stay when compared with laparotomy. A very few cases of non-surgical management of early abdominal pregnancy have been reported. This includes case management with intramuscular methotrexate alone and combination with intracircular injection with methotrexate. Methotrexate has also been used as adjunctive treatment to surgery. Advanced abdominal pregnancy associated with significant maternal and fetal morbidity and mortality. Once diagnosed, a laparotomy should be undertaken properly. The surgical approach should be planned to avoid incision of the placenta. The placenta may be left in situ if the vascular attachment involves major vessels or vital structure as an spontaneous resolution waiting. Heterotopic pregnancy. What are the surgical, pharmacological, and conservative treatment? The intrauterine pregnancy must be considered in the management plan. The management approach adopted for the heterotopic pregnancy should incorporate the prognosis of the intrauterine pregnancy and the wishes of the woman regarding its final outcome. Methotrexate should only be considered if the intrauterine pregnancy is non-viable or if the woman does not wish to continue with the pregnancy, as even local injection will affect the intrauterine pregnancy. In women with a viable pregnancy who do not wish to continue with the pregnancy, abortion act regulation will be applied. Medical management using local injection of the hyperosmal glucose into the extrauterine sac or potassium chloride into either the fetal pool if possible or the sac if not. Alongside the aspiration of the sac contain minimize the risk posed to the coexisting intrauterine pregnancy by surgical approach. Ultrasound follow-up is necessary in this woman to ensure resolution of the ectopic pregnancy as BHCG level cannot be used. This approach has been described for interstitial heterotopic pregnancy, caesarean scar heterotopic pregnancy, cervical heterotopic pregnancy. Surgical removal of the ectopic pregnancy is the method of choice for hemodynamically stable women and is also option for hemodynamically stable women. In this woman presenting with heterotopic pregnancy who are hemodynamically unstable, surgical management should be carried out. In those hemodynamically stable women with the easily accessible ectopic pregnancy, such as tubal, cervical, or interstitial heterotopic pregnancy, surgical removal is also option. Ectopic management is the option in heterotopic pregnancy, where the ultrasound findings are of non-viable pregnancy. Ectopic Management of interstitial heterotopic pregnancy is symptom-free woman with ultrasound evidence that the interstitial pregnancy was not ongoing has been described. Do rhesus negative women with ectopic pregnancy require antibody immunization? Immunoglobulin. Over antibody prophylaxis as per national protocol to all rhesus D negative women who have surgical removal of ectopic pregnancy or where bleeding is repeated, heavy or associated with abdominal pain. Immunization as per reported following ectopic pregnancy and 27-25% of cases of ruptured tubal ectopic pregnancy associated with significant number of fetal cell in the maternal circulation. Women who undergo surgical management of ectopic pregnancy may be at high risk of cystization due to mixing of fetal and maternal blood. NICE recommended only ovarian antibody prophylaxis to those undergoing surgical management, but this is contrary to the British Committee for Standard in Hematology guidance. Long-term fertility prospect. What are the long-term fertility prospects following ectopic pregnancy? In the absence of the history of fertility or tubal pathology, women should be advised that there is no difference in the rate of fertility, the risk of future tubal ectopic pregnancy or tubal patency rate between the different management options. Women's previous history of fertility should be advised that the treatment of their tubal ectopic pregnancy with expected on medical management associated with improved reproductive outcome compared with the radical surgery. Women receiving methotrexate for the management of tubal ectopic pregnancy can be advised that there is no effect on ovarian reserve. Women undergoing treatment with uterine artery embolization systemic methotrexate for non-tubal ectopic pregnancy can be advised that live births have been reported in subsequent pregnancy. Women undergoing laparoscopic management of ovarian pregnancy can be advised that their future fertility prospects are good. There is no difference in tubal patency rate as examined by hysterosalpingography and the woman whose tubal ectopic pregnancy were managed expectantly or medically in the ipsilateral tubes or among those managed expectantly, medically or surgically in the contralateral tube. Several studies have examined various measurements of ovarian reserve following the medical treatment of tubal ectopic pregnancy and concluded that there is no effect on anti-Müllerian hormone, intral follicles count for or ovarian responsiveness. There is some evidence that if fertility treatment is recommended within 180 day of methotrexate, the oocyte yield is low, but the study size was small. The future fertility outcome of women undergoing laparoscopic surgery for ovarian ectopic pregnancy were examined in small case series, which showed that 100% went on to conceive again, with 83% achieving a live birth. Thank you.